1867, Albany was booming in population and business in America was moving from an agricultural-based economy to that of an industrial-based economy. With the Civil War came the industrial boom of manufacturing-based economies in American cities, in particular those in the Northeast. With the post-Civil War era came the expansion of transportation by both rail and water, as well as a boom in population of American cities. Up until 1867, Albany, like many other cities, was served by volunteer firefighters. With the changing makeup of America's cities, it became evident that more and more fire departments would have to hire full-time firefighters to be responsible for fire suppression in their cities. Albany was no exception. Throughout the early 1840s, 50s, and 60s, the city had numerous fires, including one conflagration. These fires had been fought by local volunteers using hand-operated pumps. Until this point, paid professional firefighters in America were scarce. Cities could not afford to pay the up to 40 men per take to pump on the hand pumpers. Steam-powered fire pumps had been demonstrated as early as 1840, but the volunteer departments rejected them. The first steamers were heavy, somewhat difficult to operate, and slow to build pump pressure. But once put in operation, a steamer could pump indefinitely, and it only took one man to operate it. It would not be until after the Civil War that steam would play a major role in the fire service in America. The war had taken so many young men that many volunteer companies could not field enough men to man the pumps. The cities were growing, fire losses were rising, full-time departments using steam-powered pumps were the answer. The organization of the paid fire department in Albany was brought about by an act of the New York State Legislature and signed by the governor on April 16, 1867, to become effective on June 1, 1867. Just prior to the organization, a Mr. Brandon, a surveyor for the Home Insurance Company of New York City, was paid by the city fathers to give his recommendations pertaining to the needs of the city of Albany. Mr. Brandon was considered to be the best surveyor of this kind in the country. Mr. Brandon previously helped recommend and reorganize the fire departments in New York, Chicago, Philadelphia, Baltimore, Nashville, Memphis, Detroit, Cleveland, and many other large cities through America. Based on his recommendations, as well as a local citizens committee, it was decided that Albany would have a full-time professional fire department. The first apparatus were pulled by a two-horse hitch. This was later replaced by a three-horse hitch. In 1873, Albany, like many other departments across the country, were changing to the new quick hitch. The quick hitch was a harness suspended from the ceiling of the firehouse, enabling a much faster hookup to the horses, saving valuable time in response to alarms. Throughout the early years, the boilers of the steamers were also remodeled and equipped with Fox boilers. The Fox boiler was a new type of boiler in which hot water circulated through the tubes of the boiler. This enabled the steamer to be put into operation quicker. Hose in the early days was made of leather. It was rolled up on large hose reels on the day. The amount of hose carried on the reel was usually 700 feet. At one time, Steamer 8 was equipped with two hose carts due to the area which required long hose stretches. Then came the introduction of the combination chemical and hose wagon and water hose. The mechanical difficulty of manually cranking an area ladder up by hand led to the search for new methods. In 1892, the Seagrave Company developed the manual spring assist. Twin lifting springs raised the main part of the aerial ladder, while cranks and worm screws extended it. In 1905, American LaFrance introduced a spring assist which featured hydraulic cylinders to control the extension of the ladder. This was the first step in all the hydraulic systems that would later predominate. By the beginning of the 20th century, most cities in America would boast having a modern professional fire department with horse-drawn steamers, hook and ladders, chemical wagons, and coal tenders. Change was in the air, however, and soon this modern equipment would be obsolete. Soon motorized equipment would take the place of the horses. Motor drive units were first fitted to the steamers and ladders. As new apparatus was purchased, the gas internal combustion engine would pull the rig and pump the water. By 1923, the horse-drawn fire apparatus was gone. The gas engines were continually improved and enlarged to as many as 12 cylinders and over 300 horsepower. The genesis of the fire department consisted of 150 officers and men divided into six companies. For a short period of time, Engine 13 was allowed to stay in service as a volunteer company. Shortly afterwards, Engine 13 was reorganized into Engine 6 as a paid company. Without a doubt, one of the foremost influences on the modern Army Fire Department were policies set in place by the late Chief Michael J. Fleming. Chief Fleming joined the department in 1892 when it consisted of horse-drawn steamers and wooden ladders raised by hand. The chief went through the transition from horses to the first motorized equipment to modern diesel apparatus and metal aerial ladders. For 76 years, Chief Fleming served the Albany Fire Department. Of those 76 years, 45 were spent as chief. On December 1st, 1968, Chief Michael J. Fleming retired as chief of the Albany Fire Department. Before retiring, the chief was responsible for the introduction of many firsts in firefighting in the Capital District. Under Chief Fleming, the Albany Fire Department was first to organize a rescue squad. Albany's rescue squad was officially formed on July 29, 1929. The first rig was a 1928 Mack. This company not only responded to every fire call in the city, but many times responded to outlying communities who had no heavy rescue unit. Another first for the Capital District was the introduction of the first metal aerial. In 1939, Ladder 2 placed in service a 1939 American LaFrance 85-foot metal ladder. Until this date, all ladders in the area were wooden. Another first for Chief Fleming was the organization of a drill school and a drill tower. Emphasis on drilling and training was a major characteristic of Chief Fleming's command. Ultimately, other fire departments would contact Chief Fleming for input and in organizing their own drill schools. At the time of his retirement, Chief Fleming had been chief for 45 years. His record as chief officer of a professional department is unbroken. Throughout organized departments in Europe and North America, there is no chief who has ever served as long in command as Chief Fleming did with the Albany Fire Department. In 1929, a new office building was constructed on 11 North Pearl Street. It was designed by Marcus Reynolds, who was the architect for the D&H building, as well as Hook and Ladder 4 on Delaware Avenue. It would be the tallest building north of New York City and the city's first high-rise tower. There would be many more to follow. Firefighting in Albany would never be the same. From a high-rise downtown, a large Victorian pine hills, a farm in the port, or to a row house in Arbor Hill. Albany had it all. With hospitals, churches, schools, hotels, warehouses, ships, auto and brush fires on any given day, the Albany firefighter could face any challenge of modern firefighting. Throughout the years of the Albany Fire Department, there have been many notable fires and disasters for which the members have been called to respond to. Throughout its history, members of the Albany Fire Department have consistently represented unselfish and dedicated service. So dedicated have the city firefighters been that in the last 127 years, 50 members of the department have made the supreme sacrifice in the performance of their duty. No department within Albany metropolitan area has had so many members killed or injured in the performance of their duty. The greatest loss of life for members of the Albany Fire Department would occur on December 19, 1892, when four members of Engine 4 were killed while operating a fire at the Fort Orange Mill. A wall collapsed, killing all four members while advancing a hose line. A year later, on December 30, 1894, 16 citizens would be killed when a fire tore through the Delavan House. The Delavan House was built as a hotel on a city block down by Steuben, Montgomery, and Columbia Streets, as well as Broadway. It would be the largest loss of life by fire in the history of the organized Albany Fire Department. Chief Fleming responded to the Delavan House fire as a hoseman on Engine 1. Their company became trapped inside when a wall collapsed, cutting off their water and their exit. Hoseman Fleming and crew would eventually find another way out from the second floor, out a window, onto Broadway. Throughout his career, Chief Fleming would describe the Delavan House as the worst fire he had ever fought. On March 29, 1911, a general alarm would be sounded for Signal Station 324 for a fire in the New York State Capitol Building, West Wing. One man was killed and millions of dollars of damage was done in the fire, but members were able to contain the fire to the West Wing only. On March 17, 1928, Signal Station 915 was transmitted for a fire at Memorial Hospital, located on North Pearl Street at the time. Seven people ultimately died and many were overcome by smoke. In 1960, the department, like other departments, began to face arson on a regular basis. Many buildings in downtown were aging, often vacant. Other buildings housed more people than they were intended for. It was not uncommon for fire companies in these areas to fight multiple blazes in a single day. Also in the 60s came the expansion of the election night fires. On election night, it became traditional for bonfires to be lit in celebration of the victorious Democratic candidates. These fires soon had a darker side, as often vacant houses were set ablaze, sometimes connected to occupied structures. From the 60s to the late 70s, Albany firefighters would routinely battle several multiple alarm fires in a single night. The intensity of the election night fires is highlighted by the fact that election night, 1967, Engine 5 in the South End, in a 16-hour period, would go to 19 structure and debris fires, of which 8 were second alarms. In 1969, members of the Albany Fire Department won the right to collective bargaining. For the first time, members of the fire department would negotiate with city government on issues of pay raises and benefits. Albany Permanent Professional Firefighters Association, Local 2007, was formed. This was a long, hard battle for the firemen. They were up against one of the oldest and most powerful political machines in America's history. The victory for the fire department would be one of the greatest losses to Mayor Erastus Corning and Uncle Dan O'Connell in their 70 years of power. In 1978, the fire department, for the first time, would formally expand its role. No longer would its mission be just fire suppression. In 1979, the department broadened its role to include emergency medical services. With the advent of EMS, the department would provide both basic and advanced life support. Initiation of emergency services, the department's incidents and responses would increase dramatically, over 16,000 calls yearly. On a per capita basis, the Albany Fire Department is the busiest fire department Department in the last years has built three new firehouses, one of which contains new headquarters. The department has replaced all of its older apparatus with the most modern equipment available. Most of the older firehouses, some of which date back to the 1800s, have been renovated. EMS has been completed. All members of the fire department are emergency medical technicians with the option of becoming paramedics. The department has also received funding for a hazardous materials unit. One thing, though, has not changed since 1867, and that is the dedication of the members of the Albany Fire Department. Whether responding to an auto wreck or a structure fire or a heart attack call, the members continue to serve unselfishly and with the utmost professionalism, regardless of the task at hand. This continuing funding and maintaining a well-equipped, well-manned, and well-trained fire department.
Now see, this is the New Scotland amplifier. This is Paul's cleaners.
Yep.
The back of it, the cleaners blew up more or less. Caught on fire, I think. And that this particular fire, this is the fire where we... I'm telling you, we had a wall of fire here. But we were up in an attic, in this fire on the top floor, and we were ordered out, and everybody bailed out, and I was pulling the line, Captain Bennett said to me, he come back and he said, I was the last one down. He says, don't play that line through. Get that line back down. So I'm reaching to pull the line and it stuck because some stuff had fell down and I'm pulling it. And finally, when the line gave way, it came back and went right over my shoulder and he was standing behind me and it popped him right in the mouth, broke out all his teeth. Never forget that. Now, at this particular fire, Brophy came to this fire and he set up a command post right in the intersection of New Scotland Avenue and Moore Street, New Scotland and Dana. He set up a command post there. He was our chief at that time. The two battalions that worked this was Tommy Wink and Jack Martin. And then there's Paul's cleaners. Boy, I tell you, the place was engulfed. Engulfed. Surprise. Is this just the port where the train hit the, I got the aftermath. I was here for this. The squad came down. This is where we used the dry pot, you know, the dry foam
yeah.
With the hopper.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the squad set it up. When we got it out, and the aftermath of when we took the body out of the truck. What happened was the truck was trying to beat the train across the tracks, and both of them were empty. The train was empty. It was a grain train, which was, I think, partially empty. And there was the oil tanker that was supposed to be all empty, and it made quite an explosion. This happened at the far end of the port. Yes, in that picture. I think Eddie Robinson probably was in five. Either Eddie Robinson or Captain Cow. I can't remember which. That was injured. That's the accident. Now, you know, he was responding to a fire on Pearl, just south, just north of Livingston. We had fought the fire for about an hour and a half, thought we had the fire out, and actually did have the fire out in the building we were fighting it in, and unbeknown to us, there was a connecting building with a connecting beam, and the other building was fully charged. And it was such a hot, miserable day, if I remember, that there, for whatever reason, Jack Martin figured we were too exhausted, so he transmitted the second, you know, and one was coming on a second, and what happened to this accident was they were coming across Lexington, and they were just one standard ship, they were just winding it out. Seven was coming down to cover at Engine One's quarters, and the woman that had the bomb there, so she was coming up the street, she heard the sirens and the lights, and when she seen Seven coming, she assumed that that's what she was hearing. So she continued to drive straight across, and she drove straight into the path of Engine One. Much fire involved and get in and come in the back way. Okay. That was close to the corner of Grand Street.
Where
that was
this the kids? Where are they, in the front?
The grandmother and the two kids were in the front, right underneath one of the windows. Either the first or second floor is right on one of the windows. Yep. But probably these windows here that show the fire. That was really a sad morning. This happened like around 8:30 in the morning, and I think the school crossing guard might have called it in.
Oh,
yeah.
Right
on weekday, yeah. We were out picking up reports with the chief's car. Yeah, we went over this. This is still on Madison. But some of the guys come around. There was an alleyway right around the corner on the Grand Street side that brought us into this fire. Yeah, this a lot of work that morning.
That took all three buildings, didn't it?
Yep. Yeah, there's St. Anthony's Church just below the corner. Oh, yeah. Boy, it was... It was a tough morning that morning. It's a lot of fire showing. We had no idea there was anybody in the building either. You know, we had no report of anybody in the building. That was like an aftermath when we found them.
A mask on that guy, Tom. See, that looks like a filter mask. It is. See that, like the yellow in front of him?
Yeah.
That's a canister. The only ones who had Scots were the squad. These filter masks. You needed a certain so much atmosphere for them to work. If it was too smoky, they wouldn't work. And if it would work, you almost didn't need them. Through a filter, yeah. Now, we never used them, really. You see, there used to just be a little indicator on it. One side was blue and one side was white, right in front of a little window. When it all turned light blue, then they were no good. You threw them out, you got a new one. But nobody ever used them. Correct. Like this guy's out in the porch, probably got in there and didn't work, you know. There's enough smoke. How did you fire? Dick Fleming was the one who saved that whole fire. Bravery was going nuts. Bravery was the deputy, and Dick was the bat chief. He said, we're taking this as three fires. Told Bravery, you take that corner, I'll take this corner. I think Andy Schreiner took another corner. And that's where they ran it. They just took so many companies and went to work on the fires. They didn't even communicate, you know, with one another. Just went, yeah. Was three separate fires. What was the son of a gun? I was on that. We threw a dresser out of a window, and the guy come up to the room screaming. We're cleaning the places out after we had it all put out. Think about his dresser. He had $3,000 in a dresser. Collecting. No, he had it. He went down, he found it. Yeah. Yeah, that was all of a fire. Radiant heat. Just radiant heat, yeah.
It was a windy day, George?
Yeah, it was like in the fall, like early fall. Maybe like around September or that, you know. I forget offhand. I know it wasn't hot out. It wasn't cold out, I mean, it was hot, you know, it was warm. When you came back to a fire like that, when you got called in, you went to work, you get paid for it. There was nothing extra in the paycheck. No. That's it. And if you had to work the next day or you worked the day before, or, you know, made no difference. Come on down and give us a hand putting this out. And that was all there was to it. No. And even when it was out, then you had to stay there and pick up poles. They sent the snorkel, drove in the whole neighborhood, just putting out spot fires on roofs with the boom up, yeah. Yep. After that fire, the mayor told the governor. He said, that's it, we're not going in and put these things out anymore. They were supposed to have water to the floor above the fire. They didn't have water to like five floors below it. And we could actually say we didn't put it out. It was like the 22nd floor. It burned itself out. So from then on, we weren't even going to go in. And they made a liaison officer between the city and the state. And who they made was the chief I was driving, Dan Doherty. So him and I were at all the big conference meetings with the state, you know. It's a good job. You have to really see what was going on. But that was it. It was just like that shower of embers.
We weren't even going to be there. I think nine broke down, and they sent us, because we didn't go on a third. Look at that baby go. Look at that. How you talk about some red?
Oh, this is nothing.
And I'll tell you what, there was 11 of them just like that. The only fire I ever went to where they gave away a building. Dick Fleming ordered the building out. It just started burning. He said, forget this. We'll go next door and we broke the walls down next door and broke the ceiling out. It's coming. We'll stop, try to stop it here. And that's where we stopped it. That was going south. Going north, the brick building stopped it. It stopped it going north that way. It was roaring, Joe. See, I'm pretty sure that's the Crown Beauty Salon. It goes right down. Oh, that's right where we were. Right in front of it. S-s-s- Isn't it? See that? Crown Beauty Salon. See that?
Yep, that's Crown. Yep,
that's right. Where we were. That might have been us on that line there. Eddie Duncan and myself. See all that fire, you can't believe a human being could be as cold as we were after. When we knocked this down, it was the coldest night I've ever been. Every muscle in my body ached from standing there going, we had no clothes on. We had the little rubber coats, and it was 17 below, and wind chill factor was some 20-some below. They all headed for the church. Stump.
Is it?
Then the old monitor tops were bad too. They were heavy as hell. There's stories behind some of the goofy things we did with them. Chewing off a back porch with them and went to the garage roof. Oh, we got quite a few stories on them. We had the only tools for that. We had a little, just like have tools to shut the lines off. They used to get it. They were like sulfur candles. Yep. It's just above school six. It's below Lark. School six was down there on the left. And his name was Willingham. It was January?
February 1st.
Yeah.
And he died down the street.
His skin was coming right off him, poor bastard. And other two shacks down below, they should have went, and they never did. Remember the guy built the extension on one of them? Who put that stuff out? Eddie Robinson.
Yeah.
Up in the corner, there was a freezer room. There was a skylight. He went up through there into that attic. You couldn't see, it was a double roof. The fire was all in between. It had a metal ceiling, and nothing came down. It was breaking through. Skinny Jack and myself tied a rope. We went right through that building, right out to the loading dock. We couldn't find nothing. Where the hell? That was a hot day.
Should we take an inch or an inch and a half or up there?
Well, we didn't have any light. We just wanted to know how deep it was. You couldn't find it. We kept breaking through, coming, knocking it down, but you couldn't get it. George Byer got knocked out in the street here. Who else got treated here? Ralph Dorm got treated here for smoking away.
Good size door.
Oh, yeah. See, up in the corner, that's where. Yeah. There's a door up there, and Eddie went in there. Engine 4. Was he in 4 then? He might have been engine 4 then. He was just a firefighter then. It's a loading dock.
Okay, yeah, it's a loading dock in the rear.
In the rear.
Yeah, it's like it's getting worse here, doesn't it?
But a lot of that's all above. It's all...
pushing down.
Yeah. You couldn't get in there, though. You might have a picture of George going down.
Triple blue stamps.
I think Wally got all the... See, that's the door. That's the doorway.
Yeah, now that side's really going.
Yeah.
We were responding to an Alabama fire at number 49 Edgewood Avenue in Albany, and it turned out to be a plane crash in number 50 Edgewood Avenue. The thing that was probably very notable at the time on our arrival was normally when you pull up, it's quite chaotic, the scene with the people, noise, and you know all the normal things that go on in a fire. This one here, we pulled up, there was a lot of people present, but the street was dead silence. You could almost hear a pin drop.
No voice, nothing.
Nothing. It was very silent. That was the first clue that we had that something was really wrong. Then we noticed that there was a building, looked like it was in a state of collapse. But what was hard to miss was this great big tail section sticking up in the air. This is the house. So, this is the normal house, all right? That's the normal house, right there, all right? This is the house shifted, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So when he hit, he shifted the entire house, and then the weight of it come down and crushed the plane. Mm-hmm. That, and naturally a second alarm was transmitted immediately to get more help there. The first reports we had, as I said, was a stewardess was in the trapped in the back of the plane. They knew that because they could see her. Also had a report that there was a guy who was 5 feet at the time when this plane went in. The rage ran the lower section of the house. The tenant upstairs was home. He was recovering from a broken arm. We sent engine 10 to the tenant. She was riding in the rear of the plane in the seat facing her, and the plane impact came and got her. It was quite serious injury. We were able to find the guy. All of that taking place simultaneously. We said, "Dad's look for the guy." We said, "People into the back of the plane." Four people downstairs and I walked out of the house. The guy up in the car brought him out and he died. One of the first ones that was alive at the time. And as I said, he had a broken gas on him. He was recuperating. The real heart of the whole thing came to light when you walked around the back of the building and seen the nose of the plane where it came up out of the structure. Plane went in, literally the front door of the house, in the garage door, through the basement angle, hit the back yard, and came and the house collapsed and crushed the plane. So seats broke halfway up the plane. They naturally stood, and that's where we were. We were able to go around, as I said, in front of the plane. And of course, now bodies had through the side of the fuselage also. So, when we looked into the plane, you could see somebody waiting there, so we knew we had some problems. So that the big operation took place. And of course, by this time, the first alarm assignment there, the second alarm assignment, all on its way there. Some of them had already arrived. Engine 11, who was one of the on the first assignment there, because at that time we had three engines and a truck come in on a call, plus the rescue squad and two battalion chiefs. So we had a pretty good response. We had about 20 people on the first line. When Engine 11 came in, they were assigned the duties of stretching lines, because we didn't want this thing to catch fire. One of the other tasks that we were assigned was to find the guy upstairs. We had no idea if his wife was home at the time. So we had to go upstairs now and look for her while this other operation was going on below. You have to remember that this house was thrown around, so it was not on its foundation properly. It had collapsed. So you had floors that were on a 45-degree angle. This guy had some very heavy furniture. Now it all slid against doors. So you're up there trying to pull doors open with dresses and everything else slid against it. So it was really a mess. It was a trying time for everyone to try and get through there. The power was still on. And when we had gone up into the second floor, we dislodged some debris. And of course, one of the wires that was hanging now started, got whacked and started to hit the building. It was arcing. We had gas lines that were severed, so we were trying to get the gas shut off, the electric cut, and, you know, try and do all these things at once. The water was even running. So we were afraid to be in the plane was under the house and the house crushed the plane. We were afraid to say, okay, let's foam this area because we had all this fuel. We had all this jet fuel in the basement. They dropped it right there, and you could smell this. You smell the gas. You could, you know, see the electric arcing. So we said, if we try and foam this thing, we could literally drown our survivors. So we were in sort of a quandary. And at that point, the best thing to do was just stand fast and do nothing as far as applying water or foam. So we just went into this tedious job of first you had to pull the dead out of there in order to get to the living. We were doing that on the front end of the plane where they broke through the fuselage. We also went under the side of the house and was able to cut through the skin of the plane and get in there. And one of the things that really amazed me was the fact that these two people were just sitting in their chairs. They were still buckled in their seats and they were talking to one another. They were in some kind of shock, but they were talking, and they were talking in a rather normal, calm voice. When we attempted to remove these people, they were begging us, just leave me right here, just leave me alone. And on examination, the guy, his feet, I looked at him, they were facing back the other way. Both legs were broke, and we were able to undo them and gingerly lift them out of there. Most of the people we were bringing out, on impact, people get pretty well entangled in their clothing. And the one guy that I vividly remember seeing, because his tie was, it was almost like somebody hung him with his own tie. It was so tight around his neck. And we were trying to get, you know, things like this loose to, you know, if there was any chance of him surviving. He was one of the dead ones. Some of the more gory things were, at that point of the plane under that building, there was only like a foot of room in there, so we had to use porta powers and jack up the house and now crawl under that. Of course, you were shoring everything as you went. And you crawl under that to get to other bodies. And they were so entangled back there that, you know, you thought you had one person. And when they were trying to untangle him, the guy says, no, get him apart there. And he's, what color shoes he got on? He's got brown shoes. Well, I'm holding a guy with black shoes. Things like that. I remember Tommy Grenier, who was on the rescue squad, asking me if I could crawl down between the foundation of the building and the plane and push somebody's head back inside the plane so they could remove him.
a car was stopped in the middle lane, whether it was stopped because the gentleman refused or because he lost power to the vehicle, no one really knows for sure, except that a truck who was traveling in the middle lane, well, came from behind, tried to stop, but couldn't, and he rear-ended the vehicle. And there were two kids trapped in the back of the vehicle. When we received the call, we responded, and as well as Engine 2 and the paramedics from Engine 2, Engine and Rescue 2. And it was in the morning, probably around 10:30 or 11, but it was a heavily traveled day. The traffic had already picked up quite some ways. So it took us a few minutes as a heavy rescue unit to get there. And when we finally did get there, the paramedics had already taken out one of the victims from the rear of the car, and the two people in the car were out, had gotten out on their own, and were kind of being tended to. Although they were in a daze, they were being administered to by members of Engine 2, and the paramedics were working on the children. However, one of the kids was trapped in the vehicle, and we had to use some of our hearse tools and some of our hand tools to free the second child.
Several times. Got suited up en route, and on arrival, got off the truck, went inside, myself and Elston Mackey, found a free burning living room, and report from neighbors that the bedroom where they were was past the fire room. So we went through the living room and into the bedroom, and I found an overturned chair, and underneath the overturned chair was the girl, the little girl. She was unconscious. And I found her, and I couldn't get over the chair to get the boy. I could hear him on the bed, so I yelled to Elston. And when Elston came into the room, I took the girl out, and Elston managed to get the boy out. And we had to come back through the fire room and out front, and they were both unconscious when we came out. They were revived.
Subsequently, I went in the room and I searched, and I seen the little boy on the bed, but I thought he was a doll. And I still picked him up, and at that time, I still thought it was a doll because he was so limp. And I put him closer to my face where I seen it was a little boy. And at that time, I took him out of the room, and we started to resuscitate him right on the sidewalk out.
Engine 2 responded to a second alarm on Clinton Street. We arrived, there was a heavy volume of fire showing out of the main fire building and also the building connected to that. Captain Rankin, Firefighter Mino, Firefighter Musel, and myself all responded to the front of the building, where the BC told us that there was somebody on the third floor. At that point, was working on the rescue, and we were ordered to take a additional line up to the top of the building where the victim was. That was the main entry, the main stairwell. At that point, that it was best for attacks at that point, and we pretty much forced all of our efforts on that part of the doors. Apparently they had found a male, 2 pounds. At that point, already had the clothes burnt off of him. Extensive third-degree burns on his body. From the TAC unit, all the individuals were made in getting the individual out. The size of him, where he was found, the fact that he was extremely difficult just to maneuver. At that point, then, continued the fire on the second floor, forcing the fire back in the air shaft. Quite a bit of the spreading. Once after the interior attack began on the second floor, they had the victim down landing and were proceeding to take him outside. Shortly thereafter, as soon as they got him outside, everyone was ordered. We went around the back of the building with a staff and went to Masters. After we went to that initial exterior attack, it took close to another couple of hours before the fire was brought under control.
Sure, they used to start it with a crank. We never had a crank. We've done more of this. Get in the back end and push it out the door and go down the back end.
Oh, God. Swansea, Merritt Madison Avenue. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's it.
He's the first one of the bozo. Whereabouts? Anybody see anything? What's that sign over there?
Garage. Same street.
Oh, that's the school.
Okay, here we are. Snorkel, First Shoes, North Pearl Street Garage.
Except they're in the wrong spot.
Yeah, they're on the wrong side.
They're going to move this.
Yeah, now they're moving it around, because that's the old precinct there, the school.
This be 4th and Donegan, Bob?
Yeah.
Davis Acoustical?
Yeah, Davis Acoustical. Oh, baby. That burned for 3 days. That burned for 3 days, that bastard did. And it burned 2 or 3 times.
August 13, 64.
Yeah.
Just so there.
Guys, the snorkel almost got burned.
Snorkel?
What's this one here?
This is still it's Davis.
Same one.
Yeah.
Special pumper 3, special pumper 10,
yeah.
Truck 2, pumper 8.
No third alarm,
A second alarm and then special for 3, 10, truck 2, and 8.
Sounds like a third alarm fire.
Black Widow tip on the snorkel there?
Yeah, it looks like it. Yeah.
They almost got caught in the basket. Winchell's got some good pictures.
At this?
Yeah, the basket came in way too low, and when you see the flame, it shot out, and they had to pull the basket away. It almost got burned. Winchell had a couple good pictures of it.
Yeah. And you sit right in Engine 5's front dooryard and watch that fire.
It don't look like those streams you're doing are all black.
Nah, shit, you weren't touching it. Like I said, it used to be the lumber company was in there before them. You know? So just, crazy, huh? Wow. Oh, yeah.
This happened during the daytime.
Oh, yeah.
It was a good sized building.
Yeah, around lunchtime it happened.
Yeah.
It started, anyway. center section.
Yeah, center section.
You see it? The flames coming out, boy. Just.
Looks like they're pouring gasoline on it.
Oh, yeah.
What's going on?
Look at that black smoke.
Yes.
Yeah. Right there by the train crossing.
Huh? Real babble in the background there.
Yeah, it was right there. Right where the One Project sits there.
Right at One.
Avenue and Broad Street.
Yep, Second Avenue, 155 Broad.
Yep. Tommy Mahar's kid lived on the second floor there. And it got into this third house up.
Look at that house, way in the back and way in the front here.
Yeah, well, that's like a garage underneath the house. Oh. It drove into the backyard.
All right.
Yeah, that's how the fire spread.
Wow. Yeah. Where's that one house that's like that stuff?
There's 10 of them.
Over in Phillip.
Yeah, there's 10 of them. 10 or 12 of them. There's one right up Phillip and Myrtle.
Oh, yeah, Myrtle. Sorry.
Right. And then on Sherman Street, there's two or three of them like that on Sherman, too.
I guess.
It ain't that house on the corner right up.
They're building like that right on Hudson Avenue.
Yeah.
Miller's toy store.
Yeah.
Warehouse.
Yeah.
Well, I'd say it did take the next move.
Is he
going to
head start or what?
Freebird. Paul. Paul. That 5 minute Freebird.
Yeah.
There's how he's Freebird.
There was enough heat going around down there that day. Pinky Evans was running around because he used to live down on Pearl Street then. He kept running up with his hat pushed back. What's his name? Alan was there, and it was just lucky somebody didn't get killed there. That's all. It was just lucky somebody didn't die.
Bob Dodge, 1460 to
5794, the best of the bravest from the South End Station. Thank you. Right.
Oh, will you stop?
There's gold bullion
on
you holding it right here.
Tightly.
Oh.